Edmonton, Alberta, where Canadian captain Mason McTavish is having a potentially historic World Juniors, chasing Canadian records in goals and points. His line mates have been Brendan Hoffman on the left and the remarkable Connor Bedard on the right, but a switch today. Will Cooley flip spots with Hoffman for the quarterfinals and Switzerland at the World Juniors. Of course it's sunny. Nothing but blue sky all week for the World Juniors. 4 days left, two games left here on quarterfinal Wednesday. USA Czechia later, Canada, Switzerland first. And the Canadian team back in black today for the second straight game. Future Ottawa Senator Ridley Gregg has been an absolute force for Canada all over the ice. He'll be key today, as will Dylan Garand, who starts again, the Rangers pick, with the third best save percentage in the tournament. As we say hello, Canada, and welcome to quarterfinal Wednesday here at the World Juniors. James Duffy alongside Cheryl Pounder, Jeff O'Neill, and Bob McKenzie. Sweden and Finland are already into the semis, but perhaps Canada can take a lesson from both of those games. The Finns only led Germany, despite being heavy favorites, 3-2 in the third period before getting a couple of insurance goals. And Latvia gave Sweden absolute fit. Sweden had to score a late goal to win that game 2-1. So yes, Canada should cruise today, but no guarantees in junior hockey or this tournament. Gord Miller and Mike Johnson, get you ready.
All right, thank you, James. You know, coaches hate it when you number your lines. You never know which line's going to be your best. Okay, so Joshua Waugh, William Dufour, and Ridley Gregg are Canada's checking line. Yeah, but they've got six goals in four games between them.
And they might be the most important line for Canada and for head coach Dave Cameron, because it's who they've trusted. You never would have thought before the tournament that Ridley Gregg, you know, two-way centerman from the WHL, would center, what, two offensive dynamos from the Quebec League. 56 goal scorer William Dufour leading point getter Joshua Waugh, and set what, an energy checking responsible table setting kind of line. But that's exactly what they have become. They start the periods, they get the tough matchup when they need a good shift. The coach trusts this trio, who wouldn't have been on the board before the tournament started, as a line to get the job done, and they have. So expect them against Switzerland to be very good, emotional, physical, as they have been all tournament long.
Canada is 24-0 all-time against the Swiss at the World Junior Championship. Two of the last four games, though, decided by one goal.
All right, thank you, gentlemen. Here's a look at Canada's lineup for their matchup against Switzerland. CHL Goalie of the Year, as I mentioned, Dylan Garand starts for the fourth straight game. It's basically his net now. And Will Cooley, as I mentioned off the top, goes from the fourth line to the first, swapping spots with Brendan Hoffman. Bob, Canada's top line has been so effective. Why that switch?
Head coach Dave Cameron absolutely loves what he's getting offensively from that line, but he wants a little more defensive presence because he thinks they'll be that much more dominant offensively if they do a better job of killing plays in their own end and getting the puck out along the wall. And Will Cooley, who's a big guy at 6'4", who scored 43 goals in the OHL last year. It's not like he doesn't have offensive ability, but he's got a little more defensive presence and conscience on that line to help McTavish and Bedard get off to the races offensively.
Oh, what would be your expectations for Bedard, who has 3 goals, 7 points, has been electric at times in this tournament, but barely played in the third period against Finland, mainly because of all those penalties Canada took?
He should have one goal in mind, James. He's going to go first overall. He's going to score a bunch of goals. He's going to make a lot of money. But what he should be trying to do is 20 years from now, sitting down watching the World Juniors, James Duffy pulls up a Canada clutch board in elimination games. That's what every player wants, and if you're on that board, that really means you're a special player. He's been fantastic. Obviously, you talk about the playmaking, the shot, but to come through in the clutch, it's like Sidney Crosby, the golden goal. When you're associated with that, it just makes it that much better.
Canada should control this game. Discipline might be the only thing they need to worry about. And do they take solace in the fact that when they've taken penalties so far, the PK has been really good?
What was really effective, in particular in the third period against Finland the other day. And, you know, there's a few things. You have to be able to anticipate and recognize when to pressure versus contain. They do an excellent job right here. Send it down 200 feet. And then the ability to communicate. You see DeFore in the middle of the ice. That's the second thing. But he's steering on an angle. So there is an arc. So he's pushing to the outside. He recovers to the middle. And again, when you steer on an angle, you can accelerate and close on the wall. Extremely effective, PK.
With Sweden and Finland winning those games earlier, if Canada wins and if the USA wins against Czechia later on tonight, it would be Canada-Finland in the semifinals. But an awful lot of hockey to be played. And as Gord mentioned, the Swiss have a long history of at least playing really tight games in big games at the World Juniors. The drop of the puck right after this on TSN.
Welcome back to Edmonton. It's quarterfinal Wednesday of the 2022 World Junior Hockey Championship. Two are in the books as Finland and Sweden have advanced. And now Canada takes on Switzerland in the third of four games played here in this arena today. The officials for this game are Sirkka Hunias from Germany. Jonas Kova from Finland are the referees. Nico Jussi and Josef Spurr work the lines. And starting a goal for Switzerland is the 19-year-old Noah Patnaud, played for St. John in the Quebec Major Junior League, but suffered a season-ending injury in December and missed the rest of the season. An .883 save percentage in the tournament. Dylan Garand, 3-0 so far, a .930 save percentage in the tournament, allowed three goals on 25 shots in Canada's win over Finland. Marco Beyer, second year of the coach as coach of the Swiss national junior team, was an assistant coach for the World Championship team the last couple of years. And Dave Cameron knuckles down as his team enters the knockout stage of this competition. Canada 13-3 all time in the quarterfinals. Switzerland 4-8.
All right, boys, let's rock and roll.
And away we go. Canada in black is the home team, has the last change. Bouncy puck at the line. Olin Zellweger trying to knock that down. Pokes it ahead. And that's batted back out by Switzerland's Attilio Biasca. Swiss have a young team in this tournament. 15 of the 25 players on their roster can return next year. Brought in now by Noah Delmont. He's spun away. And that pass goes off the skate back to the line. Kept in, but Pianiccio played it in from outside. And the Swiss have to tag back up. Donovan Sabrango looks ahead for DeForo, chips that back down, and Logan Stankover goes after the loose puck along with Kent Johnson. This line's been effective as well. Forrester tries to dig a three. Johnson works on it. And that's knocked back by Joel Henry. And the Swiss captain, Simon Canak, plays it back ahead. Ronan Seelig from Olds, Alberta, plays that ahead. Stankover feeds it back across. Fires at home, and Canada's got the lead, a minute and 7 seconds in. Tyson Forrester strikes early.
If you got to chip the puck out to the neutral zone, you got to reset your system, and Stegoven breaks down the Swiss right there. The ability to step inside his defender, Dionizio, take it to the forehand, and then put it right on a tee for Forrester. And it makes it all happen. He dumps the empty net, and that's exactly the start that Canada wanted. They saw for Sweden, and they saw for Finland. Close games, nice. They can get uncomfortable. The belief of the opposition grows as you go along. Canada want to get on the board early, and they do.
Forrester has now scored in three consecutive games for Canada. Native of Alliston, Ontario, is a Philadelphia first-round pick. That puck stolen away, and fed across, and a quick chance there for Attilio Biasca, the stop made by Garand. This was an issue for Canada and this line in the game against Finland, getting hemmed in. Hence, Will Cooley's up with McTavish and Bedard, who had just 30 seconds of ice time in the third period of the game against Finland.
And yet it was Cooley's turnover that started this whole defensive zone sequence.
Farney spins it back in deep. Now picked up by Lucas Cormier. He spins back. And now Cormier does a 360 as his pocket picked up by Farney. Barney bumped there by Del Mastro. This is a continuing situation from the game against the Finns where the Canadians had difficulty getting the puck out.
Got to clean up the puck management, routes, battles.
Simone Canuck plays it in. That shot gets down from Jonas Taibel. Depaul plays that back down. Taibel plays for Moncton in the Quebec Major Junior League, one of the co-hosts of the upcoming World Junior Championship in December, along with Halifax. Back at the point, that shot in. A deflection on the point shot by Brian Zanetti, and this game is tied at one. Simon Canuck appeared to get the last touch, and the Swiss have tied it up.
You're right, Simon Canuck responds, and it was all a function of not getting clear, is mishandling pucks. Bedard's still out there, and Cormier's still out there, Del Mastro, and they don't win the battle up front. Brister on in. Canuck is one of the better Swiss forwards. Big body, can handle around the front of the net. Nice little tip, no chance for Durand, and what a response for Switzerland. Huh? They go out there, they hand McTavish's line in, get a change, point shot, shot and goal. And back to square one.
Canuck spent a couple of years with Portland in the Western Hockey League. He's playing his third World Junior Championship, would be his fourth. He was ill for one of them. But the Swiss have been a tough out here. They lost 3-2 in their opener to Sweden. They were beaten 7-1 by the U.S., but then a 3-2 win over Germany. A 3-2 loss rather than Germany, a 3-2 win over Austria. Zellinger shoots, rebound, put right on goal. Another chance in front, and that front from Dinoyer was taken away. So the Swiss have not been blown out. The U.S. game got out of hand late. In fact, they came back and tied that one early as well. Zellweger up ahead for Dufour. He got bumped off the puck, and Zellweger back with it. The Swiss are the only team so far in the tournament that has come back to tie a game against the United States. They were down 1-0, evened it at one. Canada has trailed once, gave up an early goal to Czechia. Here comes Ridley Gregg across the line along with Dufour. Gregg comes steaming in. And squeezed along the boards by Maximilian Sterling. Head back down with Canadian zone. Dionicio plays it in. Durand knocks out away. Games that we talked about it. The Swiss have been tough on Canada over the years, especially at the senior level. At the Olympics, they shut Canada out in Torino in 2006 and took them to a shootout in 2010. World Championship, they've been tough as well.
Just got to know that it's going to be difficult. They'll keep it tight. They check hard.
Now Canuck looks the puck free. Canuck drops it back, and a quick chance there for Seidler. That's turned away. Another good chance for the Swiss. Nervous moments here, the opening moments for Canada, as Waugh gets ahead for Dufour. And Dufour chips that back down to the Swiss zone.
D-zone coverage. We heard Dave Cameron trying to talk about it. Canada's looked so good, they've won their games comfortably for the most part. But their play on their own end hasn't been perfect. They haven't had to do it very often because they have the puck so much. But when they get down their end, there are breakdowns.
That pass was knocked down by Johnson, working rolling puck back in front. Stankle,
we had it. Second poke, it was in the empty net.
O'Rourke fires it back down to Johnson. He gets loose behind the goal. Johnson works that free. Lost a handle for a moment, plays it back in for Stankoven. Now Johnson back with it. Back with Forster. Johnson spins, tries to throw it back in front. Stankoven skated by it. And it's brought back out by Fabian Ritzman. Ritzman winds his way in. Del Monte knocked the puck up. Del Mastro, rather, knocked the puck away from him. 4-3, the shots on goal in favor of Switzerland. 5 minutes into the first period, a 1-1 tie.
Switzerland going to be very passive. They can't get the forecheck going. They will line five up, back up, and reach to the neutral zone.
Took a minute and 14 seconds for the Swiss to come back and tie the game up as McTavish goes in for Bedard. Bedard drops that back for Sabarenko. Feeds for Zellweger. Olin Zellweger banks it back down to Bedard. Spins back in the corner. Delamont steps into him. And now Will Cooley pokes it free. Sabarenko steps back up. We have the two lefties on defense for Canada. Bedard got spun around. He looks back at the official. And it's kicked back out by Joshua Farnie. Sabarenko, crisp pass ahead for McTavish. McTavish back to Bedard. For the trailer, Zellweger bounced off his stick. Sabarenko to the side of the goal, that bounced away from Cooley. Now Cooley bats at it, and Sabarenko jumps back up. McTavish back for Sabrango, but the puck squirted away and over the line. Zellweger centers it, bounced away from Bedard, and Joel Henry back to pick it up. Long lead pass finds Canuck. In on Thompson, and Canuck pivots back again. Centers it, that bounced away, and off the stick of Joel Henry, who was alone in front. Now Denoyer brings it back. Drops it off to Othman. Denoyer in, shoots, put that wide. Ostapchuk with it. Now bouncing puck to Othman. Feeds it ahead. Ostapchuk in, shoots, it goes off a skate. Cormier back across. Seeley sends it in front. That's knocked down by Henry. And played ahead. Sent to the Canadian zone by Rodwin Dionicio, who plays for Niagara in the OHL. Ostapchuk with it. Six of these Swiss players playing the Canadian Hockey League. And there's a looming issue in Swiss hockey. They've increased the number of imports again. They've gone from four per team to six, which means that young Swiss players are likely to get squeezed out by imports. Major concern for the Swiss Federation, but ultimately it's a decision of the Swiss Pro League to do it, because they want to remain competitive in Europe.
Yeah, well, it's a very attractive place to play, and that means more Swiss players, young ones, coming over to play in the CHL.
Now, Wah with a chance, and Patino to stop on that. Sabrango plays that back to Wah. Back in for Sabrango. Sharp angle shot, deflects wide. O'Rourke steps up, keeps it alive. Into the corner for Greg. Greg back on it to Dufour. Feeds that back. O'Rourke across to Sabrango, centers it, and Wah couldn't reach that. O'Rourke back on it, to the point to Dufour. Three across the top, Dufour in a wrist shot. That's blocked by Elgay, and it's fed out by Mooglin. Sabrango brings it back around and moved up by Biaska. Head back down to Canadian zone. Carney goes after it. Switzerland won its game up against Austria narrowly. 3-2. It was 2-2 late in the third period. Austria took a 5-minute major game misconduct, and on the 5-minute power play with under 5 to go in the third, Switzerland scored the winning goal.
That was a tight one. That was winner advances, loser goes home.
Right, that was for the final quarterfinal spot. Forrester knocks it down, centers it. And that was tipped away on a good defensive play by Vincent Depot. Back is Zellweger going to pick it up. Flips it back, that's picked off. As Tybalt got to it. Down for Canuck, who has the Swiss goal. Canuck spins and shoots. Grand save. The rebound put wide. On a good play there by Henri. Kept alive by Delamont. And now Zellweger settles things down as he finds Ethan Del Mastro. 4-4 the shots. 1-1 the score. Zellweger. Up ahead for Cooley. Bedard goes after it, knocks the puck free. It's moved ahead by Nicholas Bockler. At center ice, McTavish has it back for Cooley. And a loose puck gathered up by McTavish. Canada breaking in three wide. McTavish spins back for Bedard. Now down it goes to Cooley. Cooley pivots back for McTavish. His sharp angle shot is blocked. Now Cooley throws that back. It's tipped away, but it rolls back to Seeley. From the point, Thompson is shot. That's tipped wide by Cooley. McTavish, kind of a long shift for this group. Cooley shoots at the flex high and wide. Thompson steps up. That pass broken up and now moved out by Nicolet. And just missing at center ice was Brennan Offen with a big hit. Seeley drops it back to Thompson. Last man back. He goes down. The puck comes free. In comes Switzerland. 2-on-1. Quick shot taken there by Farney. And the save made by Garand. Canada gets off to a quick start, and the goal by Tyson Forrester. But a minute and 14 seconds left later, the Swiss equalize on the tip by Simone Canuck here in the quarterfinals in Edmonton. Tyson Forrester from Alliston, Ontario. He's had a strong tournament for Canada. Goals in three straight games against Czechia. Then this one against the Finns, going cartwheeling into the goal. And then tonight, the opening goal of the game. With Warren Forrester, here's Tessa Benal.
Yeah, Gord, I'm not sure if you noticed, but it sounds like half of Alliston is in the building when Tyson Forrester scores. That's because it kind of is true. Not only are his parents here, Glenn, Sherry, and his sister, Katie, but they've got 25 of their pals here. All of them work alongside them at Honda, and they are here cheering on Tyson. They've been having a blast. I ran into them outside on the street one day, and they said that they're just so proud of him, and they love being here and cheering Canada on. So let me tell you, Alliston, you're well represented here in Edmonton.
Quick shot there by Alan Spock, turned away by Grant, and there are his parents, Glenn and Sherry. Forster playing for the first time internationally for Canada.
What a great experience. To share family and friends and to feel that support, and so many small communities rally behind the successes of their young athletes that go on to achieve big things. And Forster's gotten better as this tournament's gone along.
Dare we say that in the first half of this first period, the Switzerland's had the edge in play?
Yeah. Yeah, they've had, at the very least, pretty darn close to even.
Sabrango lifts it high in the air for Waugh. Bouncing puck skipped away from him as this line goes back to work. Craig walks in. Backhand shot. Patino down. The rebound cleared away. And back down the ice. That'll be an icing call against the Swiss. The faceoff back down to their zone.
Good job by Greg. Not surprisingly, taking it right to the net. Canada's got to start trying to churn over some more turnovers like this one. And then Greg doesn't try to go behind the net, find a better option. He takes it all the way across the front of the net. Scramble opportunity, rebound potential, and everybody crashing in. Waugh, Dufour, and Greg takes the course of that one. But you love the fact that he takes it to the far post, not in behind the net.
Off the draw, Stankoven, the number one faceoff man in the tournament, lost that to Farney. That puck appeared to go into the Swiss bench, but play continues. As Forster brings it in, goes one on four. That's picked up by Delmo. Up for Canuck. And Simone Canuck spins back. Loose puck goes right to Stankoven. Logan Stankoven in, shoots, and Patino gets a piece of that. One thing the Swiss will need is a strong goaltending performance from Patino. It's been pretty good so far. Now drop back in the high slot. Canuck couldn't get a shot away. Stankoven tied him up. Here's Canuck back with it. Scored against Germany in their group stage loss. Centering pass with Cormier that was knocked away by Delmo. Got a stick on that. Picked up by Henri.
A high stick to Forster there. Got and flipped play on the back check. No call.
Play continues. And it's back down to the Canadian zone. Ronan Sealy with it. Takes it back across to Thompson. Lead pass for Cooley. Across to McTavish busting in. And so McTavish works in. Just started stick gets in the way. McTavish throws it back in front. Cooley bats at it. And back at the point is Thompson holding. Thompson to McTavish. Works in. Hook check there. Gathers it back up. At the point, Thompson shoots. That took a bite out of Matt's Algate. He's limping noticeably. That really took a bite out of him. That was Jack Thompson catching that flush. On the Swiss bench up cheering the shot clock. Thompson back on it. Drops it back to McTavish. McTavish across the ceiling. Walks it and shoots. That's on the skate. Rebound score! Jack Thompson on the rebound. And Canada's back on top.
Jack Thompson jumping down to the back door. But you said it, Cord. He took a bite out of Algay with a one-timer, and that's his left winger, the guy in charge of handling Thompson on the pinch, on the backdoor movement, and poor Algay, he can't even feel his feet, barely moving around, and of course what happens? Look who floats down to the back door and beats Algay to the spot. His unfortunate bounce jumps right on the stick, and a smart finish. Sometimes you're better shooting it on the ice than up under the bar. Thompson rips it home to give Canada the one goal advantage again.
Zellweger up for Dufour. Jack Thompson had a great year this year for Sault Ste. Marie in the OHL. Tie for the OHL lead in goals by defenseman with 21 on the year. Now picked up by Greg. Bounced down the line for Sabrango. Works it and shoots off a stick and wide. And scoop back up by Seidler for Farney. Seidler comes racing in. throws it back across. Durant down. That's knocked away. Moved back to center ice.
That's interference, no?
I would think that the Canadians
and
are hollering.
Greg felt that on his shoulder. No one touched the puck yet. And you're not braced for that hit because you don't think you're going to get hit because you haven't touched it.
Now behind the plate, Del Mastro knocked down DuPont. And Zanetti comes over to have a word with him. A hard-fought first period here in Edmonton. 6.5 to go here in the opening period. And Canada's back on top on the goal by Jack Thompson. A 2-1 lead on Switzerland in the quarters at the World Junior Hockey Championship.
Offense for the defense continues for Team Canada. Jack Thompson, Canada's second goal of the night. As he kind of slides in back door and takes the bouncing puck from Seeley and fires it home. Right along the ice like a proven goal scorer would. He puts it in the air. Goalie can catch it. Might get his paddle on it. On the ice. Nothing that the goaltender could do with that one. And prior to, this is what really Greg was complaining about. No one's touched it. No one's touched it. That is textbook interference. And Greg was a little bit shaken up from it. And the bench erupted as well. In the break, there's a conversation between Dave Cameron and the official wondering where was the call. And
right.
The Swiss got away with that one as Dave Cameron is getting an update on Ridley Gregg's health right there. And not a good sign that Ridley Gregg down to the dressing room and off the bench.
So Canada will have to make another adjustment to its lines. Bob McKenzie and James Duffy talked about off the top. Will Cooley went to play with McTavish and Bedard. Gauthier chips it there for Ostapchuk and plays it back ahead. Bouncing puck to Ostapchuk. Looking for Hoffman. Back at the point, here is Thompson. Jack Thompson to Seeley. Pokes it back ahead to Ostapchuk. Hoffman came in big on Tybell. And now Canuck brings it back. Hook check by Seeley. And the play is offside as Chanton ran into Thompson there.
And the edge in this game has picked up the last 4 or 5 minutes. A lot of conversations, a lot of chatter between the benches. Big hits are going both ways as Thompson thinks he's got Chanton lined up, but the defenseman meets the defenseman and Thompson gets the worst of it.
So Canada does have a 13th forward dressed in this game. It was listed as Nathan Gauthier before the game began, so it's 20 skater rosters as opposed to 18 in the NHL. So
right.
Canada has 13 forward, 7 defensemen dressed.
And they have several centermen that are playing on the wing.
Johnson pokes that ahead, gets in behind Seedler, drops that back for Stankoven, working in back across, and just missing on that was Forster. Almost had his second of the period. Cormier walks in, he shoots, hits a leg, and the puck bounced out by Biaska. Barney swings that back, but the pass is fanned on Stankoven. Look at that post! Scores! The first one might have been in, but the second one is for sure. So either way, Logan Stankoven makes it 3-1. And Nick Mila flubbed on that, put it on a tee for Stankoven.
I was trying to say it early in the period. I was waiting for Stankoven to have a breakout game. We know how good he is, CHL Player of the Year, and he has been lights out good in this first period. Jumping on loose pucks, and I mean, that went crossbar post, and Stankoven smartly staying with it. This is, what a release this is. Crossbar post, and then shoveling back in. Stankoven has already got one assist. That makes it 1-1 in the first period. And Canada taking advantage of a gift turnover from the Swiss. You know it's in there. You know that offense for Stankoven is in there.
He had an unreal
playoff.
Kamloops in the West League, 17 goals in 17 playoff games. 4 hat tricks in the postseason. That shot taken by Zanetti, who was the trigger man in their first goal that was tipped in by Canuck. So Canada, 3 goals on 8 shots here in the first period and a 3-1 lead.
This is the challenge of playing it against Canada, though. Even if you play well, don't give them much.
They're so good offensively, they capitalize.
Nicolette works it and shoots. That was blocked by Sabrango. Brought back in by Chantal. And at the point, that long shot deflected wide from Becklin. Becklin picks up the loose puck. Banks that back to Chantal. Cross for Dillamall. That was blocked by Cooley. Ritzman spins and shoots, and Garand makes a good stop there. Here's Zellweger back with it as Canada makes a change. Well, this is a stop chuck between Dufour and Waugh on that third line for Canada in place of Ridly Greig. But the loss of Ridly Greig for any length of time would be huge for Canada.
5-on-5, 5-on-4, any penalty kill situations.
His penalty killing in the third period against Finland, blocking shots. He was incredible in that round-robin game against the Finns to wrap up first place in the group. Big wide pass for Waugh, missed. And Patton will play that away. Waugh plays it back around. And Dionicio out to center ice. That's knocked down and played in by Biasca. Cormier, rink wide pass for Denoyer, and Denoyer sends it down. Tybell tries to clear that out. Henri now plays it high off the glass, over the head of Cormier, and back down to the Canadian zone. And back to pick it up is Ryan O'Rourke, the Bowmanville, Ontario native, who plays for Sault Ste. Marie in the OHL. Bowmanville just east of Toronto. He's a Minnesota second-round pick. From the Sault Ste. Marie Greyhounds, feeds it ahead. Denoyer with a chance, score! On the follow, Nathan Gauthier makes it 4-1.
You said something about the need for a good goaltending performance for the Swiss to hang in this game. Not getting it, but this whole play started by Gauthier right here. That one touch pass at Denoyer in stride, and then get on your horse. Terrible rebound control of Patnaud. He kicks it around in between his legs, doesn't know where it is. Gauthier stays with it, tucks it home. And a good job by the officials not blowing that puck dead as it was rattling between the pads of Patnaud.
And we will get a goaltending change for the Swiss.
That will spell the end of Patnaud's night.
That's 4 goals on 9 shots. Kevin Pash will come in. Plays for Omaha in the United States Hockey League.
That's got to be disappointing.
Yeah, reading for Patnaud, who's a returning player, plays in the Canadian Hockey League. Pash was pulled from the U.S. game after allowing five goals on 30 shots. Not sure why you make the change there.
3 minutes left. You probably could wait to the intermission. That was a bad goal, no question. He had a backdoor Forster one-timer. He had a Stankova double bar.
So Patnaud's had nightmares against Canada. He played one game in the 2021 World Junior. He allowed 10 goals on 52 shots and a 10-0 loss. Now he's got 14 goals in 4 periods in 2 games to Canada.
That's tough sledding. Tough sledding.
And he's not returned to the bench yet. He's standing in the hallway. Austin drops it back for Seaman. Feeds it back across. Oh, good stop there by Pash. On the deflection by Offman. Canada with 2 quick strikes here in the period. Stankovic, followed by Gauthier. It's a 4-1 lead on Switzerland in the quarterfinals of the World Junior Hockey Championship. The Women's World Hockey Championship gets underway August 25th to September 4th. Canada opens against Finland. Tournament in Herning, Denmark.
Beautiful.
First time the Women's World Championship will be played in an Olympic year. And there was Patnaud.
So tough. I mean, you want so badly. Yeah. And you know as a goaltender, you can be the difference maker. You can will your team in with a lifetime performance. It just didn't quite happen to him. And now Bash steps in. And this is a really good save after Patnaud. What's the last one in? That ended his night.
Pash played very well in the December tournament that was postponed against Russia, held him to 4 goals, and was terrific. Zellweger shoots, kicked away by Pash. Switzer was ninth last year. As that long shooting is gloved. It'll be no worse than eighth this year. The teams, by the way, will be reseeded after the quarterfinals. So the highest remaining seed will play the lowest remaining seed. The middle two will play each other.
Canada wins, U.S. wins, which they both should. Canada will get Finland.
Yes.
That's, unless something strange happens, Canada's the top seed. Finland would be the bottom seed. If everyone who's supposed to win does. It was close games up to this point.
Really close. Today. Latvia gave the Swedes all they could handle. Stankoven plays it back across. Bouncing puck to Forster. Goes back to Zellweger. Zellweger. Long shot that goes off a skate and wide. Stankoven picks it back up. Johnson. Tied up there by Miley. Gives it right back to Johnson. Another giveaway by Miley. Rebound loose in front. And Stankoven couldn't quite reach it. It's been a nightmare first period for Nick Miley. One giveaway led to a goal. Another almost did.
Real.
Zellweger. Ball's in front of Hollenspach and now picked up by Sobrango.
Had a few guys blow tires in this third game of the day.
In comes Cooley, feeds it back across. McTavish tipped that wide. McTavish with an assist here in the first period, extends his tournament point lead. Cooley. Down to Bedard. Connor Bedard winds in, shoots, and a blocker save made by Pash.
Kind of the first foray into the offensive zone for McTavish and Bedard, and you could kind of hear the crowd rise, and Bedard starts rolling around the top. A little give and go. Confuses the Swiss defense in a switch, and that's a goal-scoring spot for him right there, although McTavish was teed up for a one-timer that he was looking for.
1:03 to go in the period. McTavish in for the face-off. Wins that back cleanly. And Bedard shot flutters wide. Is McTavish back on it? For Cooley. Will Cooley. Back to Cormier. Long shot. That deflects wide. Del Mastro steps up. Keeps it down to Cooley. More chance in front. McTavish turned away point blank by Pat. Cormier. Back across to McTavish. Mason McTavish, 14 points now in this tournament. Works in, pulls, passes down, and now picked up by Henri. The tournament record for Canada is 18 points, shared by Dale McCourt and Braden Shen. McCourt back in 1977, Shen in 2011 in Buffalo. Time ball taken down. There's not been a penalty yet here in the period. And Chesbias will score! Arturo Biasca walks in, it's 4-2. 8.2 seconds left in the period.
That's a big goal to keep Switzerland involved in this game.
He had the goal, the power play goal that won it for them to get them to the quarters.
Good battle won in the corner. And Wah gets pitched the wrong side and Del Mastro, and then it's another player in the slot where there's guys around them, but they don't quite have him covered. Cormier covering the bad ice. Stapchuk and Bedard not really doing anything with Biasca, and he makes a nice move and finish upstairs.
Biasca played for Halifax in the Quebec Major Junior League last year. He had 11 goals for them, 3 assists.
Cy Young winner. Oh, you shoot like that, I'd shoot all the time too. In a moment of less than perfect coverage in their own end by Canada.
At the horn, contact made, but Canada go to the dressing room with a 4-2 lead in an up and down opening 20 minutes. You're watching the third of 4 quarterfinals on this Wednesday at the World Junior Hockey Championship. Our first intermission coming up with James Duffy, Bob McKenzie, Cheryl Pounder, and Jeff O'Neill here on TSN.
In the biggest game of the tournament so far, the best period of the tournament by a margin for Kamloops BC native Logan Stankoven. Goal, assist, interview with Tessa Bonnell.
Logan, the Swiss seemingly not going away. Is that
follow the scouting report that you had gotten for the team?
Yeah, for sure. I think they play a fast game, and they only have 9 or 10 shots, but they strike quick, and we had some good sustained zone time, but they're obviously able to create some chances and capitalize, so hopefully we can clean that up in the second and third.
You clearly came to play today, goal and assist in that first period. Walk us through the first goal that you helped set up.
I think it was just more of a quick up play. I think Seeley made that play up the ice to me, and I just saw the defender kind of had his toe caps outside, so thought I'd kind of jump to the inside, and I had lots of speed, so I was able to beat him and kind of make a play to Tice there, and he made a nice play to finish it off, so it was good to see.
Nice plays. Let's talk about your goal. I mean, it was just, don't worry, guys, I got this. I'll do it myself. Get the shot, clean up the rebound. Was that your thought process coming down the ice?
Yeah, I had a couple other chances right before that, too. And, you know, you only get so many chances in one game. So it was nice to kind of get that broken play there. And, you know, I was like, you know what, thought I'd shoot. And luckily it hit the crossbar and came right back to me. So I was just there to put it in.
Awesome. Well, good luck the rest of the way. Keep having fun.
Thank you.
Logan described it well, but we'll get these guys to describe it. Cheryl Pounder, Jeff O'Neill, and Bob McKenzie. For the first four games of this tournament for Canada, it was all McTavish, Bedard, Greg. Stankoven, for the reigning CHL Player of the Year, was relatively quiet, not in that first period. What changed? What impressed you?
Jimmy, I actually talked to a scout yesterday. It was by accident about Stankoven. I didn't know what I just said, hey, who are you here to watch? And he said Stankoven.
Yeah, because you never actually do research.
I know. I was not prepping or anything for this game. Anyway, don't ruin my story. And he said next year going into camp, he's just got to determine where he's going to play based on what he does in training camp. And if he goes out there in Dallas and does what he did in that first period, he might have a chance to play some games in the National Hockey League. He was a spark that Canada needed because it was kind of sleepy through for 10 minutes. He breaks in the first goal and freezes everybody with an awesome assist. You saw some back check. You saw it all from this kid, a well-rounded game. He's got some bite to his game, and then he ended the period with a great goal. He goes bar down right there. It doesn't go in. It does what every great goal scorer does, follow the puck to the net, and he put it in.
Yeah, that goal and an assist, and you talked about that, him just being the heartbeat in this particular period, and that goal was certainly something. You know, he showed a display of getting into the heart of the coverage, and this is critical. A beautiful pass by Seeley in full flight, so this allows him to get in and then push to the middle of the ice. All eyes are on him, including Patineau, and square at the top of his crease, a little dish over to Forrester, and he's able to bury it for his third. So again, just the ability to read exactly where you are on the ice, get to the middle, draw everyone into the heart of the coverage, and then kick it out.
A pretty good offensive period for Canada and a 4-2 lead, but two minuses. We'll get to the defensive breakdowns in a second, but first, Ridly Greig. It may not end up being a factor in today's game, but if the injury is significant, how significant is the loss with a potential semis and perhaps a gold medal game ahead?
Well, in many respects, Ridly Greig has been the most consistent performer for Team Canada. Somebody who's won faceoffs, he's killed penalties, been on the power play, he's scored goals, he's made plays, he's been hard to play against. He's really been the jack of all trades for Team Canada, and he takes a hard hit right in front of the Team Canada bench. It looked as though, we're no doctor, but looked like maybe left shoulder, and you could see right away he was injured on that one. Goes over, gets some attention from the trainer, goes to the dressing room, does not return, and when Dave Cameron gets the word from the trainer as to what's going on here, doesn't look all that encouraging, but we don't know. But nevertheless, if Ridly Greig doesn't return to the hockey game, significant loss. If it's even worse than that and doesn't return to the tournament, even bigger than that.
Mike Johnson touched on it last game. He's so significant because you can match him up against the other team's top center. And he said sinking his teeth into the matchup and even dominating it, so he'd be a big loss, James.
The other minus, defensive breakdowns against a team like Switzerland. Yeah. What exactly went wrong on both plays?
Well, just a very loose performance by Team Canada at times. I mean, they had the 4-1 lead. They get the late goal that makes it 4-2, and they've not been sharp defensively at times in this first period. The Swiss are getting easy zone entry here, and this is a rush chance where they've actually got a scoring chance off the rush. Good job by Del Mastro to play, but watch this play go below the goal line. Everything's all set up, no problem there. Now all of a sudden no pressure on the puck whatsoever. Too much of a gap there, too much of a gap there. Bedard goes out, tries to block the shot and doesn't get it. Here's the second one. Again, you've got an outnumbered situation or even in the corner. That should never be a problem, but everybody gets mesmerized by the puck. Bedard out for a couple of goals against in that one, even though he was only minus one. Just a loose defensive effort all the way around.
Well, a lot of point shots available too, because the coverage is certainly sagging. You notice that, so they have to have their head on a swivel and be very aware of where the puck is and also where they're supposed to be in their coverage. And you saw that last goal, of course, with Ridly Greig out. Now your lines are all messed up. So you can certainly see that the communication is going to have to be spot on as they head into the second period because they're going to be playing with different players.
First 10 minutes, this game and the last two haven't been good, and they're going to get away with it here, I would assume, against the Swiss team, James. But if they got a real quality opponent, you fall asleep for the first 10 minutes of a hockey game, it could end your tournament, so that's something they have to address moving forward.
Usually, we have to wait until the end of this tournament before we know the groups for the next World Juniors, but because of this odd summer World Juniors, because there's no relegation, we know already who the groups are, and we will let you know right after this. Craig Button will join us to go over the groups for Halifax and Moncton for the 2023 World Juniors, which is only a few months away. Canada up 4-2 on Switzerland. The first intermission continues here from Edmonton at the World Juniors. Friday Night Football, we have a doubleheader for you. Boy, the Elks and the Red Blacks both need a win. Ottawa's 1-7. The Elks are 2-7. That's your first game at 7 o'clock Eastern Time. And then the remarkable Nathan Rourke and the 7-1 Lions take on the 5-4 Riders. That should be a dandy. 10 o'clock Eastern Time on Friday Night Football. As promised, here is your very first look at the groupings for Halifax and Moncton. As you can see, Canada will be in with Sweden, Czechia, Germany, and Austria, the U.S., Finland, Switzerland, Slovakia, and Latvia. Again, the reason they've done this is because there is no relegation. The IIHF went through the last 5 years on performance at this tournament and rank the countries that way, and thus we have the grouping. So all the folks out in Halifax and Moncton, you know exactly who you'll see. The Canadian group playing in Halifax, the American group playing in Moncton. Here's our Craig Button. First of all, Team Canada. We don't know exactly how it will look. 11 potentially back. The headline will be, of course, Connor Bedard.
And it should be the headline, because if you go back to two of the under-18 championship that happened in April of 2021, that Canadian team dominated. Mm-hmm. And Connor Bedard was a central figure in that domination. So when you look at that group and how they beat everybody, and it wasn't, I mean, Russia was a good talent, but they're not here. Canada has to go into the 2023 World Junior Championship as a favorite.
Olin Zellweger, another key guy who was expected back for this tournament. Would you say, of the big four, without Russia there, Sweden, Finland, Canada, U.S., is there one team, from what you're looking at and the players available, that would be a clear favorite?
I would say USA is ahead of Finland and Sweden. I think USA and or Finland and Sweden, rather, you know, looking at their group of players, they might be a year away from that age group being able to compete against the 19-year-olds. But this is a 19-year-old tournament. I think the USA is positioned that way. I think Sweden and Finland, and remember the 2024 championship is in Sweden.
Right.
They might be set up perfectly to really compete for gold there.
So for now, maybe Canada, USA co-favorites, yes. And they've been the best two teams in this tournament so far. Of the teams below, is there any of them that look to maybe take a step up at Christmas?
Yeah, well, I would hope it would be Slovakia. You know, in the postponed tournament this previous December, Slovakia looked really good in Red Deer. But they had Slavkovsky, they had Simon Nemec, they had Filip Mazar, really good players. Now, they weren't here with Slovakia. Slovakia had a very disappointing tournament here. If they get two of those three players, and I think they will get Nemec and Mazar, they're going to be a much better team. And if they get Slavkovsky, I'd say look for them to take a real step forward.
And Latvia, who's got an incredibly young team here and impressed so much, we'll talk more about them in our second intermission, as they gave a real scare to Sweden today in one of the earlier quarterfinals. Craig Button, thank you for joining us. We'll be back in our second intermission. We have a second period just ahead. 4 for Canada, 2 for Switzerland, through 20. Second frame next. Different goal scorers for Canada in that first period, and none of them named McTavish or Berard, which is different from the first four games. The shots close, as you can see. 13-10 the advantage, and we'll see if that late Swiss goal gives them anything going into the second. Attilio Biasca has been terrific for them the entire tournament. Gordon MJ with the call of the second.
Thank you, James. You know, Logan Stankoven has a glittering resume from last year, the CHL Player of the Year, a star for Kamloops. You were waiting for him to kind of make his mark on a game in this tournament.
Well, you see what he did this year. You saw how well he played in the playoffs. You know the big moments are not too much for him. And you also could appreciate how much of a leash he was given by the Team Canada staff. He's been the second-line center on the first-line power play the entire tournament, right from the get-go, even when he wasn't necessarily producing a whole bunch. And you're just waiting for him to break out. And fortunately for Canada, this first period was his breakout period. He could add 3 or 4 points alone in the first period. He was all over it, making good plays. You see the kind of hands and vision he has in tight spaces that make him so good. And so much attention on Bedard and on Matavish. Well, Stankoven saying, hang on, we got a second line. We got other players here that can create offense. And he was very good in the first period.
Now the bad news, Ridly Greig, we're told, will not return tonight.
Oh boy. So hopefully that's precautionary. They do have one day between the quarterfinals and the semifinals.
So the Ottawa Senators first rounder from the 2020 draft, who's been so important for Canada in so many ways, out tonight after a first period collision, which you thought was interference.
Which was interference.
Yes. Yes.
Same thing.
Kent Johnson up in for Stankoven with Forster. Here they come again. Stankoven pivots back. Drops that back. Sabrango shoots. They get through. And a save made by Kevin Pash.
And the legend of Ridly Greig was growing quickly throughout this tournament. And see the left arm dangle. Takes the brunt of the impact. No one had touched the puck yet. He was kind of hunched over, thinking about reaching for the puck, and was squeezed off the play, and eventually went down the room and not coming back tonight. That is a significant problem. Maybe not tonight, but going forward, they'll miss him.
Thompson, a long shot. He's got a goal in the game. Puck loose in front. Bedard trying to knock it down at the line, held by Seeley. Skips by Seeley, back to center ice, and Connor Bedard has it back. Bedard up for McTavish, that skipped away from him. And Dionizio plays it back in for Switzerland. Banked around by Garand to Seeley. And Roman Seeley spins it back across to Bedard. Bedard turned 17 in July. And his pocket picked there by Canuck, but it's kept alive by Cooley, who plays it back in. Big hit there on Stroila. And a knock back by Allen Spock. That shot deflects wide from Farney, who had a strong first period for the Swiss. Cormier up ahead of Bedard. Chips that to the line, but not out. Fiasco plays it back in. Rolling puck. And Cormier has it back. Lead pass for Watt, chips it back down as Canada completes the change. So this will now be Denoyer in between Watt and Dufour.
And Dave Cameron's got to figure out on the fly here exactly how he wants to shuffle the deck, because Greig played the middle in such a pivotal role. It's not quite plug and play with the 13th forward, or you know what lines are working. You want to keep Stankoven's line together. You want to keep McTavish line together, so you got to pull somebody from the fourth line and put them on the third, but to play in the middle. It's a little different than playing on the wing.
Battle for the puck in the corner. Zanetti on it. Ryan Zanetti plays for Peterborough in the OHL. Moves the puck ahead. Lies it in for Nicolette. That's knocked out by Sabrango. Rink-wide pass for Dufour. He's got a step. In comes Dufour, winding in. Pulls him around. Chanton, who gets a shot away. Knocked down at the line by Zellweger. Olin Zellweger winds his way in. Centers it, bouncing puck loose in front. Got away from Waugh. And back to pick it up is Thompson. Dave Cameron's got the bingo machine out of the Canadian bench as the Lions are switching around. Dufour throws it back, picked up by Canuck. Simone Canuck for Joel Henry. Henry tries to drop that back, but as he does, the play is offside at the Canadian line.
So Canada was about to pull this game wide open as Hutton was pulled. Pasha was put in after four goals, and his first shot was this one. A backdoor tap-in for Othman. If he scores, that's 5-1, that's ball game. He makes the save, and then late in the period, Biasca closes it to 4-2, and all of a sudden, you know, Switzerland's still hanging around enough to stay interested.
see Pash wearing the Omaha Lancers mask from the USHL. Played his first year there. Bouncing puck loose in front. Ostapchuk a chance. A strange bounce off the stanchion and behind the Swiss goal almost led to a gift for Canada. Now Ostapchuk works in. Drops it back. Gauthier with a chance. Saved by Pash. Rebound. Gauthier back with it. Bit of a scramble right now in the Swiss crease, but somehow the puck stayed out. Piazza plays it back down to the Canadian zone. Picked up by Gauthier. In comes Gauthier with Hoffman. Gauthier shoots. And a glove save made by Pash.
The chance is all over the place in front of Pash, wondering what's going on in the corner here. It's a slow developing ricochet off the stanchion, and then a stab check gets the step right in it. Pasha is trying to stay in his net to watch it go behind. He had to get out quickly to make the save. And then another one on a backdoor chance to Gauthier, who I think was actually trying to slide that one back
right
for a return pass.
Cormier to Johnson. Back down, Forster. Thanks that back to Del Mastro to Cormier. And Cormier will dangle a pass to Forster. Algay. Plays it back down to Myla. That was knocked down. Yarosu had that knocked away as Cormier goes back. With this Cormier, twice the winner of the Quebec Major League Defenseman of the Year Award.
He's got great feet.
33 goals this season for Charlottetown in the Quebec League. Now wanting it is Johnson. Plays that down for Sabrango. Back around, scooped up by Johnson. In for Forster. Drops that back, Sabrango. In for Stankoven. Canada missing a change now. As Forster goes back to Zellweger. Cooley steps on, Zellweger for Cooley walking in, shoots, goal! Off the bench in the back of the net. And Will Cooley makes it 5-2.
Off the bench and into the play. You got to hustle, stick ready, and Kent Johnson starts the whole play. Look at the subtlety. Little pull from behind there. Settle things down, buy some time, and this starts the entire offensive zone sequence. Creates, and then watch him. He's taken off. He doesn't hang in the offensive zone even with possession, and it's Cooley who jumps on for Kent Johnson, who started the whole thing 18 seconds earlier, who gets lost in coverage. Takes the seam pass and shovels upstairs on the short side above the glove of the wrong-handed catching Pash. What a play by Kent Johnson. Start to finish, skill and unselfishness, Cooley gets the goal.
It's not wrong, it's right. He catches with his right hand. Cooley's second goal of the World Junior Championship. Took a 5-minute major to game misconduct in that game against Finland in the third period. Caused some nervous moments for Canada. By the way, there have been 7 game misconducts, 5-minute majors in game misconducts handed out so far in 22 games in the tournament. And they have been decisive in some cases. McTavish works back in and bounced away from him. Delamont with Tybar. Delamont in, or Delamont rather, bounces that back. Carney back for Delmo. Stroyla with a chance that's kicked away by Garand. Nick Thompson for Connor Bedard. And lead pass to McTavish. In comes Mason McTavish. Dionicio has a roll off his stick, picked up by Wah. Ben Wayne now the center on this line. So all Quebec League line. There we call it, the French Connection.
We'd like to. They can produce that way.
Allen spot. Lays that back down. Myla turns it over to DeFour. Drops that back. Then Wayne with a chance. And Dionicio got a stick on that. Myla lays it back to center ice for Allen spot. O'Rourke. Long lead pass misfires. Icing called. The faceoff back down to the Canadian zone.
It was an important goal that Cooley scored You see Zellweger, he wants the first seam. There it is, and head up the whole way. He goes right back through the same one with a little pepper on it, too. That was a wrist shot coming through. And the challenge is to handle it clean and flat and not have it bobble, not have it bounce forward. Cooley does a good job. Scores an important goal for Canada. Settle things back down, restore the three-goal lead.
So Cooley gets the promotion to the top line.
He's like, I'm a goal scorer. And he is a goal scorer. That's the funny part. It's not on the line.
43 and 59 for Windsor this year with the team captain there.
I'm not some plumber that's going to run into guys. Like, you know, I could score some goals too.
Four comes moving in with Chanton. And Villemont knocked that away. Loose at center ice. Ritzman walks in. Shoots. And it's kicked through easily by Garand. A stat check plays it around. Austin racing to the loose puck. Tipped alive by Henri. The old Henri plays that back, and the puck trickled down as the shot was taken by Dupont. Will Cooley from Toronto has the fifth goal for Canada. It's a 5-2 lead. And his parents, Chris and Mary, thumbs up for the goal scorer. It is the prequel to the groundbreaking Game of Thrones. House of the Dragon, an HBO original series, streams Sunday, August 21st, and you can only watch it on Crave. Michael Dick, assistant coach on the bench.
And they're working on flowing with the puck and away from the puck there. You see the slashing through how to find lanes because that line is getting stretched out. That was McTavish, Bedard, and Cooley. And again, they haven't played in the offensive zone every shift. They've had some moments. Watch Pastor's stick here, though. He's worried about Bedard in the back door. Look where his stick is. He's got it turned over to block the pass to a back door, and that opens up more space up top for Cooley.
And another great pass by Oleg Zellweger.
They can snap it around.
78 points in 55 games this year forever, a franchise record for defensemen. Just an FYI, 78 points for anyone is a good year.
That's a good year for an offensive player, forward, let alone a defenseman. And Zellweger, right from the beginning, has stood out. Him and Zabrango were the top pair.
From Fort Saskatchewan, just northeast of here, was the Western Hockey League Defenseman of the Year last year. Won gold with Canada at the 2021 IHF Under-18 Tournament with McTavish and Bedard and others.
I want to see him and Jamie Drysdale together.
Oh.
Running up and down the ice in Anaheim. And
I think Drysdale could play here.
He's still good.
He's an 0-2.
Yeah. And there is room in the NHL for undersized, puck-moving defensemen who will hurt you with offense but don't hurt their team defensively. And Zellweger, he'll find a spot. He's really good.
Chip back down to the Swiss zone. Another icing call against Canada. Switzerland won one medal in the tournament. It was back in 1998. They were relegated in 2008. They were scheduled to host the 2010 tournament that Saskatoon and Regina finally got, but they were worried about getting relegated on home ice. So they withdrew from hosting that tournament. Switzerland will host the 2026 Men's Worlds. I mean, Swiss hockey is kind of riding a high right now. You think about, you know, Roman Yost is one of the top defensemen in the league. Zarella puts that wide. Kevin Fiala is a great player. Nico Hischier was first overall in the draft. I mean, there's lots of good stuff going on in Swiss hockey. There's a real concern, though, about going from four imports to six and the effect that's going to happen on young Swiss players. Now Stolen Biaska in, shoot, scores! Akino Biaska fires again, and it's 5-3.
Biaska continues his very strong tournament for Switzerland. Sloppy play below the goal line for Canada. Starting with their own goaltender, Dylan Durand, doesn't help his own cause. Has the puck back here, not sure what to do with it. Patient, puts it in a tough spot. Brangle trying to find Stankov and doesn't connect. And if you don't connect, Stankov has got to worry about Farnie stepping into it. You put your team in a tough spot, and Durand never quite gets back, settled and out on the edge of the crease to challenge Biaska. And it's back to two.
Four goals in the tournament for Biaska in five games. Long shot put away by Pash. He's done a good job since coming in for Patinoak in the Swiss goal. Oh, the lacrosse try there by Hoffman didn't quite work. That was the spatula. He tried to get the stick under it. Hoffman shoots. So I think I've come up with a ruling on that. It's only to Michigan if you put your blade over the puck and pick it up.
It's generically just a lacrosse goal.
If you do the spatula and slip it under, that's the spatula. But both are lacrosse goals.
Either way, Hoffman getting creative. Well, Johnson get all the attention for him. He wants in on the action.
It is funny, it's mostly left-handed shots that do it.
Although, with Pasha catching with his right hand, he's not got a quick little glove hand just to pop under the bar to chop the puck. Or maybe they're just more left-handed shooting forwards, generally speaking.
Yeah. Puck was high off the glass, banked back out by Chanton. Brought in by Henri. Yoel Henri works in. Henri spins, feeds that down, Cooley blocks it. Will Cooley back to pick it up. Crossy goes to O'Rourke. Waiting for it is Bedard. Chips out to McTavish. Back for Bedard. Rink wide. He goes for Cooley. In comes Will Cooley with a shot. That deflects wide. Cooley back on it. Spins it down to McTavish for Bedard. Banned on it. Second try. That was blocked. Don't see that every day. And Canuck back with it for the Swiss. And Bedard hammered him down. And the play's offside at the Canadian line.
Bedard's got a little edge to him.
Yeah.
When he gets frustrated and he gets going into a game, and I imagine just not playing a lot in the third period of the last game, not playing in the offensive zone all this period, missed a couple of chances here. He turns it over. He likes to see this though. Finish. Nice and clean. Good back pressure. Little details will round. We know the stuff that he already could do at a world-class level. Rounding out the other stuff is what will make him a better NHL player.
Fair to say, Mike, that you can teach him the defensive stuff. You can't teach him to do what he does.
Nope. Any good coach could teach him about positioning and getting pucks in and getting pucks out and blocking shots at passing lanes.
He does have a skills coach, and there's lots to, but I mean, a lot of that is...
And that's not hard. That's more just commitment to it than it is tricky.
NYA swings that rink wide for Dufour. And Dufour back on it.
Somebody slipped off the bench. They caught him.
Wow.
That was almost an intentional late change. Alguay was like hanging out.
It was like a sleeper play.
They were playing 5-on-4, and all of a sudden he's like, okay, I'm going to step out. Now we have the puck. Almost pulled it off. Tricky, tricky.
Alguay shoots, bouncing puck in front, scooped up by Zellweger.
Nice to be pulling guys out of one end of the bench and going in the other.
Yeah. Lead pass for Watt. Nice and called. Watt thought he beat that. Faceoff will come back down to the Canadian zone, but Mats Alguay. You want to call it the sleeper play? I don't know what it is, whatever you call it, but
I'm not sure. But Alguay, and they're laughing about it. Almost worked. Switzerland was back in the row end with only four players, and Alguay wasn't. I don't think he was changing for anyone who was hurt. I didn't notice anything going on. All of a sudden, as soon as Switzerland got the puck on the stick, he jumps on the bench to the far blue line, trying to grab a breakaway. The kind of stuff you might do when you are against a very tough opponent. You're going to pull out all the stops.
Chanton knocks that down. Dufour comes in on him, and Dufour slams into Chanton. A stop check for Dufour. Now back at the point. Thompson shoots. That ramped off the stick of Johnson high and wide. Dufour back on it. Stankoven steps on. Johnson. That is a rolling puck. Feeds that back. Thompson back around. Bounces off the glass, and Seeley steps up for Canada. Forster to Thompson. Johnson slap pass in front. Tip wide by Seeley, who jumped up. Just missed on that one. Delamo can't knock it down. Johnson did. And a quick shot by Forster. And the glove save with the right hand of Kevin Pash. 5-3, Canada leads. Tyson Forster has two, but Biaska comes back with his second to cut the lead to two.
Maybe it's going to be one of those games where last goal wins, just offense at both ends, and the most recent chance goes to Seeley, defenseman, on a one-timer that everybody in the building thought Kent Johnson was going to lean on, and he slap passes it across to Seeley. sometimes when it's that square, when it's coming right at you, it's hard to redirect the way you want. And Seeley knocked it wide, and then Forster trying to beat Pascher over the glove unsuccessfully. Kent Johnson has been dishing it around. Mm-hmm. Just in the offensive zone, his instincts with the puck are spot on. So good.
Face off, one back to Bedard. And Connor Bedard shoots. That's tipped wide by Cooley. McTavish back with it. Throws that back at the point. Thompson in, shoots. That's glove by Pag. So as a rule, left-handed goalies are right-handed catchers.
Yeah.
Left-handed people, about 10% of the population. You'd think there'd be more left-handed goalies. As a matter of, in the NHL, I think there were only 11 last year. Like it should be more, but...
Well, if there's 11 out of 62, that's...
No, but there's more than that to play in the league. Right?
Well, 11 out of 100 is still the same 10% of society.
But in junior hockey, it's like 5%.
Well, I think Canada's got to make an adjustment. They keep going top glove here. And Pasch's like, thank you very much. He's got a quick one. I don't know if there'd be much of a scouting report on the...
Oh, centering Pasch Bedard who hacked that wide.
Well, the Swiss goaltenders, but an adjustment you want to make on the fly.
Zellweger, right back in front. Bedard waits, has all day, walks out and shoots. That's blocked. And that was Stroilo who got in the way. Connor Bedard could have made a phone call while he waited.
But the good news is he's finding space. He's finding pucks in the offensive zone. The goals will always come for him as long as he's getting the looks.
Just behind the goal. Big hit there. Awesome.
You just got to be sure not to follow through too high. He didn't.
He just sent Dionicio flying. In comes Ostapchuk now. Oh, the throw got back in front.
And penalty coming up here,
too. So the first penalty of the game.
Gauthier.
Will go to Gauthier, and the Swiss have got the power play with 7.5 to go in the second period, down by 2.
Surprising to get to this point without a penalty.
Yeah.
Conversation continues between Hoffman and Dionicio behind.
Team Canada, number 21, minor penalty for high sticking.
Gauthier's taking a real long time heading to the box. He must think he's got a case here. As he was trying to drive the back post, he wants to see it. Left side of your screen. Oh, yeah. What's he? He hit him right in the face. He got him in the face. That's accidental, but clear high stick. And oh, that's a great hit by Hoffman. That's what you get for watching your path. You stare at your pass for a second, and you get finished. And two guys digging in to block on Connor Bedard. Makes sense. Put as many people back there as you can. And here, first time where Ridley Gregg, penalty kill, not out here and available for Canada. He left after taking a hit in the first, did not return in the second, and will not return tonight.
So Stopchuk out there on the penalty kill for Canada. And the Swiss power play just 2 for 15 in the tournament. It let them down in a couple of key moments. The 3-2 loss to Germany and their early loss to Sweden. They had power play chance in the third period and generated almost nothing. In comes Ritzman. Piasecki and Farnie have the two power play goals for the Swiss in the tournament. There were 7 right-handed catching goalies in the NHL last year.
Seven.
Maybe
7 out of 60, 10%.
There were more than 60 goalies in the NHL last year.
64.
Delmo with it. Back to Farnie.
Guy in front of the net lost the stick, but he won't change. He's just screening with no stick.
Here's Delmo with it. He's back across to Farnie. Delamo shoots. That's knocked away. And Ritzman was...
I'm not sure about that strategy.
Canuck comes off the bench. Knocks that free for Allenspach. Dario Allenspach, who plays for the Swiss League champions, EV Zug. Piasecki shoots, put that wide. Here's Canuck back with it. EV Nicky Zug won the Swiss League Championship in spectacular fashion last spring. Farney spins away from McTavish. Farney still with it, walks in and shoots. Put that high and wide. The puck bounces at the line, kept alive by Allenspach. Knock. Back to Allenspach. Rink wide to Farney. Farney goes rink wide to Allenspach. Final second just power play, and that's cue wide by Farney. Farney back with it. Down to Canuck, little backhand shot, that's deflected away. One shot on goal for the Swiss Club power play. Remains a 5-3 game. That long shot taken by Seidler into the midsection of Garand, and he hangs on. 5:19 to go in the second period. Canada's got his hands full with Switzerland in the quarterfinals of the 2022 World Junior Hockey Championship.
Well, sometimes we joke the guy in front of them, the power play, is a bit of a decoy. We joke in practice, stick optional, because you're not even going to get a pass. You go in there and you just deflect and you screen. Well, Ritzman breaks his stick there, top of the circle. He takes it way too literally. Heads down to the front of the net, no stick, and I guess you can still screen, but, I mean, what else are you going to do? If you get a rebound, I think you probably want to get to the bench on the power play and maybe grab a new twig or...
And that long shot went off the skate.
That was tricky for Garand. And Garand, the one thing about him is he has a very calming demeanor in net. He exudes cool and confidence. And in this game, he's kind of been fighting a little bit. Broken plays, three goals against. For the second game in a row.
23-16, the shots on goal in favor of Canada. And Kevin Pash done a good job since coming in for the Swiss. He came on late in the first period in place of Noah Patinot, who allowed four goals to Canada on 9 shots. By the way, just to finish the thought.
Yes.
119 goalies played in the NHL last year.
And only 7 of them
caught right.
Caught right. Okay.
Now, there's a theory about that, that it's hard to get equipment. It's hard to get right-handed catching gloves and left-handed blockers. The weird thing is that so many hockey players are left-handed golfers. Stankovic. Because left-handed golfers are rare, too.
Apparently that was equipment related when they were younger as well.
But. Yeah. Just an oddity, but...
Oh, you know what? The oddities, that's goaltenders. That's the entire conversation.
The whole chapter is oddity. Johnson works it in.
Too many men
being called against the Swiss.
And Zabrango was tangled up with Biaska and didn't let him get off the ice.
Oh, no.
They brought the song back? What is happening?
No, they didn't.
This is the first time we've heard this whole tournament. Oh.
Team Switzerland, too many players.
They're trolling us. The sound guy is trolling us.
So Biaska's on his way towards the bench.
Right.
And Sabrango is on his way perhaps off the ice. They get kind of tangled up. And here comes Biaska. And Zabrango right there. So, you call it maybe interference for bumping in him? That's a tight call.
You're not supposed to make contact with the player or the puck.
A lot of things you're not supposed to do.
Right.
That don't always get called.
Right. So, yeah, I mean, that is a very strict interpretation of too many men.
Big opportunity here for Canada, though, because step onside.
In comes Bedard. He's onside. Shoots. Pash makes a stop on that. And fed back down to the Canadian zone. Canada comes in 6-for-10 on the power play.
That's pretty good.
Yeah. Not a lot of chances so far on the power play, which as Bedard drops it back. And Tavish back across. That shot by Johnson was blocked by Farney. And Tavish back to Bedard. Shoots. He whistled that wide. Stankoven back with it. Logan Stankoven back down to McTavish. And McTavish flips it back. Johnson holds, feeds back. Zellweger back across for Stankoven. Johnson trying to tap that back in front. Zellweger dives and keeps the puck alive. What a play from Zellweger. Stankoven back to Zellweger. Works it back across to Johnson. Walks in, holds, spins, and rolls off his stick and sent down the ice by Stroila. 40 seconds to go in this Canadian power play. Forrester for Seeley. Back he goes, and Cormier's shot goes off Pash, up and out of play.
Some close chances for Canada in and around the net. Bedard frustrated. This was a deflected pass that he just steps in onside. Didn't quite get all that one. He had to hustle, actually, to stay onside. Knew he was getting caught, and, you know, he leans on it, eyes shut, apparently, as he likes to do. You can feel him getting a little frustrated on the power play because he's not getting the touches and the looks playing that center bumper position. Teams are taking him away. There's so much traffic around him. He's just not involved.
Hoffman up ahead for Wah. Final second of the power play. Wah spins back. One shot for Canada on that power play. Forrester tries to dig that free. Hoffman comes in to help out. Forrester back for Cormier. Pivots at the line. Long wrist shot was blocked by Delamont. Bachla got straightened up at center ice, but Bianca moves it back down to the Canadian zone. Canada grabbed an early lead in this game, a minute and 7 seconds in, but the Swiss tied it up less than a minute and a half later. And it's been a battle here this afternoon. The quarterfinals have all featured battles. The Finns played the first game today against Germany. We're up 3-2 in the third period. That was a battle. The Swedes had all they could handle against Latvia in a tie game in the third period. Now a centering pass, and Henri with a chance, and Durant makes a stop on that. And the FedEx Cup continues on Saturday at the BMW Championship. Catch third round action at 3 Eastern, noon Pacific on TSN and CTV2. On the right, I think that's the Riverside Golf Course.
It's not the one we played yesterday, I know that much.
That was the Kinsman pitch and putt you played yesterday.
It's my kind of course, as Grant makes a nice little glove save. There's a little tension in the air in the building right now. It's 5-3, they're hanging around. Canada hasn't asserted their dominance in this game.
Two of the last four meetings between Canada and Switzerland at the World Junior decided by one goal.
You shouldn't be surprised, and three of the four games heading into this one in this tournament by Switzerland also decided by one goal. So they play close games.
The nightcap tonight has the United States against Czechia. That'll be interesting. Czechia's got a pretty good team here.
Nate Lehman is just going, guys, look at the scoreboard from today.
Right.
Look at the scoreboard. You think it's going to be easy? You think it's going to be comfortable? It will not.
And they've had all day to think about it. That game's at 8:30 local time tonight.
I saw them go for breakfast about 8 in the morning. It's a full slate.
In 12 hours. Zellweger back with it. Nolan Zellweger feeds it towards the goal, past the stop, juggles it, and makes the save.
Stapchuk right in front, trying to take advantage of Zellweger's nice play along the wall. Zellweger once again activating and then creating separation with his feet. Quick little wrister. Oh, Stapchuk wished he could have tipped that one down. Short side is what he was looking for, but Stapchuk save and no rebound. Graduate from the Omaha Lancers in net for Switzerland.
Johnson plays that back. Seeley drops it down. Kent Johnson works in. Dribbles that down. And it's caught. By the way, Hockey Canada and the IHF have announced the groups have been set for Halifax because of the short turnaround. Canada, Sweden, Czechia, Germany, Austria will be in Group A. So it's Canada, Sweden, Czechia, Germany, Austria. Group B will be the United States, Finland, Switzerland, Slovakia, and Latvia. There was no relegation at this tournament. We got the round robin standings finished a couple of days ago. So those groups have been set now based on ranking.
And I immediately want to
Halifax and Moncton.
Which group is harder? But you can't tell because it's not going to be the same teams. They'll turn over all the rosters.
Halifax and Moncton co-hosting. And there's a backhand shot by Dufour loose in front. Picked back out and moved ahead by Algay. Back goes Sabrango being channeled there by Bachler, who gives him a hard run. What'll be interesting to see is a team like Slovakia might have those three first-round picks in the lineup at Christmas time.
That would change the complexion
that changes the complexion a little bit, doesn't it?
Pretty significantly.
in that Group B in Moncton with the U.S., Finland, Switzerland, and Latvia. As an icing call comes with 6.9 seconds left.
And remember, it was in the last 10 seconds of the first period where Switzerland scored to get it to 4-2. So we're here with just under 7 left, trying to set something up in the offensive zone. Tavish trying to take as much time as he can, getting back to take the faceoff. He was on the chase, a little out of breath. The veteran talking to his goaltender. He's got all the tricks.
Back of the point. Chaton with a shot. Glove saved by Durand. Throws it back in the corner. And Canada will go to the dressing room with another two-goal lead. It was 4-2 after one, now 5-3 after two. It's the quarterfinals, game number three on this Wednesday, as Canada tries to join Finland and Sweden in the semifinals on Friday. You're watching the 2022 World Junior Hockey Championship from Edmonton. Our second intermission with James Duffy, Cheryl Pounder, Bob McKenzie, and Jeff O'Neill coming up.
We still have one more quarterfinal for you a little bit later on tonight. 10:30 Eastern, 8:30 local. U.S. versus Czechia for the final spot in the quarter. Sweden and Finland already in. Canada or Switzerland will take the third with 20 minutes left. And this one, James Duffy back with Cheryl Pounder, Jeff O'Neill, and Bob McKenzie. I think this has been a little more of a struggle than a lot of people thought it would for Canada. We'll get into that. But that one goal for Canada in the period, is that absolute perfection as far as controlling the offensive end while you're executing a change?
Yeah, and I've come up with a new stat. It's called half a plus. It's when you do some really good stuff, and then you get off the ice and your team scores and you get nothing for it. And that's what happened with Kent Johnson, the board play and the slick little plays along the blue line, protecting the puck. And this is great for Canada to keep the puck in the offensive zone. You see that play there. He slides it down low, and then he changes. And then here's where the good things happen. It gets to Zellweger. Cooley comes off the ice. All the Swiss players are focused on Zellweger, and he just goes right to the far post and puts it in. But that whole play started with Kent Johnson. Jimmy, let's make a rally for half a plus. Half a plus, you make good plays, you get half a plus.
I would have just stood by the bench with my butt hanging out so they could see my number at that point.
A lot of guys do that. I played a lot of guys that did that.
Well, why can't you get a full plus?
Something. He needs credit.
Extra plus.
He needs some kind of credit for those plays.
What were you going to say?
Well, I was going to say that I really like the motion on it and the switches. As a defender, it's so difficult to read what the puck carrier is going to do, whether they're going to keep it or they're going to give it. And that's a lot of the time what opens up those lanes and creates a ton of motion.
I think if I told you before the game Canada would have five after two periods of play, you would think the game is over. The part that perhaps we didn't predict would be Switzerland, a generally low-scoring team, having three. What went wrong for Canada on the third goal?
Well, it certainly starts in the back end, and it starts with Garand here. He gets the puck in below his goal line, and he's looking to push it to somewhere to the outside. He has two options in Zellweger and Sabrango, and he elects to go to Sabrango, but Sabrango gets pressure right away. Now, lesson here, on your backhand, don't kick it to the middle of the ice when you're in a vulnerable position. Now, because Zellweger was outside the dots, he can't recover and get back to the middle. So therefore, it's a key scoring opportunity. Of course, they convert on Garand.
Gerald, you're on team, no backhand pass. I just don't say it for the good of my own health. When you're in your own zone, it's amazing how many times you make that backhand pass. You can't see anything, and it ends up in the back
and
of your net.
And especially when you're on the wall, right?
You're blind to everything. You can't see.
You're blind to everything, and you're popping it to the middle of the ice. You better be sure you got coverage in the middle, and they didn't.
It's been probably the number one thing you've harped on your entire career in TSN.
It's probably my best thing I go to.
You know, give some credit to Attilio Biasca, who's been, if you've watched all the Swiss games, he's been absolutely terrific through the entire tournament. So you pointed out Bedard being on for two goals in the first and had a couple of cracks on the power play in the second. MJ mentioned a little bit of frustration. Do we have to be reminded, and perhaps does he have to remind himself, that he just turned 17 and he's not going to dominate every game at the World Juniors?
100%. It's almost unheard of for most guys just turned 17 to make the impact that he's already made in two World Juniors, the canceled one at Christmas and then this one. He is another worldly offensive talent, but defensively, I mean, he's still very much a work in progress, and certainly that was the case over the course of this game. Now, MJ talked a little bit of the frustration. He so wants to make something happen there. He's got an open man on the wing. He's one on four, turns the puck over. Now there's a loose puck in his own end, and he skates by that, comes back, tries to block a shot, and again, These are not critical flaws. And as you say, he was on the ice for two in the first period. But there's no question today that line is not nearly as noticeable offensively. They've been more noticeable defensively for some of the things they haven't been able to get done in the zone.
Quickly, if Canada wins this game, we know special teams will be massive in the semifinals and a potential gold medal game. On both ends, what have you seen through that second period?
Well, in particular with the Swiss, I thought they had a lot of motion on their power play, and Canada was able to kill it. But Switzerland did get some opportunity here. There was more motion. They were able to draw players over to the puck. And when that happens, you open up lanes right there like a point shot. But the retrieval, they were able to retrieve. And then they created little two-on-one. You see a little triangle right there, a little fake to the inside, the ability to get a shot on net. And again, the seam passes. Canada not being aggressive at all, really static in their position, not pressuring the puck carrier. So Switzerland doing a good job.
And then Canada went on the power play, James. And you notice the score here. It's 5-3. And I really don't know what to make of this game. It's kind of close. And you're like, is this good for them moving forward? Do I want a blowout? Is it good for them to blow this team out? But this score is 5-3. And they couldn't really make anything happen on this power play. So you come down to the third period. It's maybe a bad penalty, a good power play. Goaltending, that's what it's going to come down to in this third. A lot closer than I thought, but maybe it's good for them.
Right. You can take positives from a game like this where you get humbled a little bit and there's lots of coaching moments for the day off, but I think Dave Cameron would probably love an absolute dominant third period when he scores.
The obvious concern is Ridly Gregg out of the game.
Right.
Find out what his status is for the tournament.
Concern for the Sens, too. Always say he looks NHL ready in this tournament so far, though there's not many spots with Ottawa up front with the acquisitions that they've made so far. But again, we'll wait and see how Ridly Gregg is. Hopefully get some sort of report after the game. Up next, Finland, Germany, Sweden, Latvia, the highlights, and Craig Button on Latvia's run here at the Juniors. Got a crooner as Craig Button in the hotel lobby after games. Finland taking on Germany. Finland with a terrific passing play early. Roope Järvinen finds Kasper Simon Teivel to finish it off. They give the Finns the early lead. Those two would be terrific all game. 2-1 late in the first, Finns on the power play. Järvinen, the Sens prospect. The Sens prospects are everywhere this tournament. Finns 11 for 18 on the power play at that point. They lead the game 3-1. Second now, Germany on the power play. Hakan Hanlett will find Bennett Rosmi, and he'll go backhand roof. And Germany is within one and hanging around. The one thing they couldn't do is take penalties in the third period of play because, well, like I said, Finland on the power play. Aleksi Heimonsalmi feeds Järvinen, and a second blast of the game. Fourth goal of the tournament, one of four power play goals on the day for Finland. Yeah, Germans gave it a run, but they lose 5-2, and they are done. Finland off to the semi. Sweden, Latvia. Latvia's first ever appearance in the quarters at the World Juniors. What a story they've been after picking up their first victory ever in group play. Scoreless late in the first. Felix Gavers on a breakaway. Emil Andrea, though, what a defensive play from behind. The Flyers' 2020 second rounder. Keeps it scoreless, still on the same power play. Look at all the Latvians, they get caught looking, and there's Isaac Rosen who buries it. The Sabres first rounder, third of the tournament, and the Swedes have a 1-0 lead. Still 1-0 in the second period of play. Gustav Oselich, Waden walking the line a little bit and just fires it through traffic, and it finds a way in. And Latvia is tied with Sweden heading into the third. Could we have this major upset? Well, opening minutes of the period, Martin Lavins, who's been so good for Latvia, but that is not good. That's a five-minute major for checking to the head. The Latvian assistant captain knows this is a major mistake. Upset in the box. Sweden, though, does not convert. A great five-minute kill for Latvia, but midway through the frame, Andrea gets it in front, and that would be your winner. Just a valiant effort for Latvia, but they fall. 2-1 is the final. And here's Craig Button, who called both of those games alongside Dennis Bayak. And we love this tournament for a lot of reasons, but it's not just the Canada-US games for gold. The stories like Latvia, who we remember had never won a game in group play, and were only in this tournament because the Russians were kicked out. I remember you calling the game the other night that they won. How would you describe the story?
Well, the story's magnificent. And, you know, it's not just what they did, it's how they did it. They did it with this incredible enthusiasm, this incredible passion, and they competed hard. They were not easy for any team to play. Even Canada versus Latvia at the outset of the this tournament was a hard game. And, you know, when you start to think about a team that's going to return a lot of players for the tournament in 2023 coming up into Halifax and Moncton, this is really significant experience. But, you know, we saw the unfortunate part with Martin Slavens, but that's not the story. The story is the fire they played with, the determination, but the joy they brought to themselves and to their country. These are moments we saw with Denmark in a previous tournament. We saw with Kazakhstan previously. As you pointed out, it's what makes this tournament special in a different way.
The thing I like best about this team is that, you know, a lot of teams in Latvia's position just happy to be here.
Yeah.
They actually really thought they could win. Remember the comment after the Canada game that, hey, we thought we were as good as them, and everybody said, well, that's ridiculous. Well, they gave a really good run here, and it'd be fun to watch them in Halifax and Moncton at the 2023 World Juniors. We still have a period left in this one, and it's probably tighter than the Canadians thought it would be or hoped it would be, a 5-3 lead. Back with MJ and Gord in the third right after this from the World Juniors in Edmonton. The SportLogic slot shots, about what you'd expect, perhaps a few more for Switzerland than we would have thought. 18-9 for Canada. The red dots signify where the goals have come from. It's a 5-3 Canadian lead. There's your second period scoring summary. Cooley coming off the bench to get that one after the terrific play by Johnson. And Attilio Biasca continues to have a tournament for Switzerland, his fourth. Gord, MJ, and the final 20.
Thank you, James. And the first 40 minutes can best be described as uneven for Canada.
Yeah, and not the kind of game they would like to play, assuming that they do move on to the semifinals. They'd like to be in full control and sharp and on point, and they just haven't been. And you know, James mentioned the 9 slot shots, which is more than they'd like to give up. But so many of the mistakes were self-inflicted, and that is where the concern is for Canada, where they had pucks on their sticks, mishandling it, misreads, misassignments, and because of it, Switzerland's made some plays, scored some goals, and kept themselves in this game. So if there's one area that Canada wants to focus on in the third period, it's not necessarily going to score a sixth or seventh. That will come by playing better without the puck, making better decisions with it, being a little bit more responsible, and giving Switzerland absolutely nothing here in the third period.
Well, a couple of Canadian players that would know a thing or two sitting next to each other, Hoffman and McTavish, played in Switzerland a couple of years ago when the OHL wasn't playing. They went over and spent part of the year there, so they might know some of these Swiss players in the 02 birth year.
I'm not sure if it's all friends out there right now. There's
a little bit of tension, for sure.
A little temperature has been ratcheted up in this game.
Finland beat Germany in the first game today. That game was close in the third period. Sweden beat Latvia in a game that was tied in the third period.
And here is late in the second, icing, and Bash got something to say to McTavish. McTavish doesn't think that that's funny. Zellweger comes by, he's got something to say. McTavish comes back again, and I like Bash not backing down from anybody. He's digging in and engaging the conversation. I love that from my goaltender. Now you better stop all the pucks, but I don't know if you want to light a fire either. I think, generally speaking, Switzerland is playing a game that they like. Canada can be much better, including Mason McTavish in his line. We've celebrated them, justifiably so. Point totals through the roof. They've been in their own end a lot in the last two games.
If you're just joining us, Ridley Gregg, the Ottawa first round pick who played for Brandon last year in the Western League, was shaken up.
It's interference again.
It's
not talking about the worst of it, but it's the same play as Ridley Gregg. He's hitting them when there's no puck around.
So Greg was shaken up and has not returned, will not return tonight. So his status will be a major factor heading for the semifinals on Friday should Canada get there.
Canada would be the top seeded team left. They would have home ice at last change, which means Greg could get matched up against whoever they want him to.
The teams are reseeded after the quarterfinals.
Ooh, got close.
Yes, Duran almost played that in the no-fly zone. Outside the trapezoid, whatever you want to call it. Here's Cooley back with it. Will Cooley Plays it back down to McTavish. Seidler at the point. The puck on the line for Miley. Back for Seidler. Shoots. Get a leg in front. Puck still loose. Dug free by Backlund. Seidler back across. Miley tees up and shoots. That goes off Cooley. And McTavish takes it off the glass. And out of race for it now. Bedard at the end of a shift. And racing back to knock that away was Seidler. Canada begins to change. Now Waugh is on. McTavish makes his way off, but Bedard stays out. Pokes that back ahead. Moves back in, and that shot gets it wide of the goal by Ritzman. Bedard's still out there. And he's picked up by Denoyer. Denoyer at center ice, moves it ahead, and Bedard will finally make his way off. Switzerland has never beaten Canada at the World Junior Championship. There have been a number of close calls over the years, mostly because of great goaltending performances by the Swiss. Now Farney with a steal, but it's knocked back to center ice. One of the high points for Switzerland, besides their 1998 bronze medal win, was beating Russia in the quarterfinals in the 2010 tournament in Saskatoon. The overtime goal by Nino Niederreiter. They gave it to the wrong guy. It took
Is this the one you've been politicking for 10 years to get switched back?
It took me a year to get it fixed. Well, not just me, but it took a year of negotiating. Back then, they wouldn't change goals. Once it was in the system, they would not change it.
Control, alt, delete, and type in Niederreiter.
The same thing happened in 2008 when Matt Halaschuk scored a golden goal for Canada. As Canuck comes in and shoots, that was played to the wrong guy for 6 months. A stop shot. Up ahead for Offen, who slides that back. Here's Sabrango. Up ahead to Offen.
He's really been missing in today's game for Canada. That aggressive forecheck. They just haven't had the speed through the neutral zone to engage physically and win pucks back in the offensive zone like they have against every other opponent.
Seidler got bumped there by Sabrango. Then comes Dariel Seidler, who plays for the EV Zug system. They were down 3-0 against Zurich in the Swiss League final. As Johnson works in with Stankoven. Johnson pulls it in, shoots, fired that wide. Zug came back from 3-0 down to win that series. The first time anyone's ever done that in the Swiss National League.
Ken Johnson's been around it again. A little delay here. He didn't quite have the speed to make it 2-on-1, so drag it, pull through Seidler. How about this? So nobody's touched the puck there again. Yes, Stankoven gets up to protect himself, and as a huge collision to Sean Toll's helmet goes flying. I'm glad he's okay. Doesn't like it. Now he's all fired up. He's taking a run at somebody else. But it feels a lot like interference. Yeah, you know. It's been a couple now that have not been called that the way I would see it.
Johnson back on it. Stankoven pivots back. Logan Stankoven spins back with a puck, goes to Seeley. Back across to Jack Thompson, has a goal in the game. That's deflected wide. As Forster got a stick on that, at the point is Seeley. Back across to Thompson, walks it and shoots, that's wide. And Johnson maintains possession. Allen's puck steps into him. Bouncing puck off the stick of Stankoven. And finally flipped back to center ice. Seeley kicks it ahead and picked up by Forster. Forster collided there with Seeley. And the Swiss bring it back. Canuck works it back in front on the back check. McTavish took that away. Simone Canuck. Long wrist shot. That's gloved by Garan. And he'll hang on.
It's been a pretty stress-free tournament for Garand as far as the scoreboard for the most part. When he's played, the team has been well in front. Even against Finland, the team was comfortably in control for most of the game. And
Canada scored at least 5 goals in all 5 of its games so far.
But on some level, maybe getting a tighter game won't be the worst thing for Canada, assuming they win it, because the next two will be tighter as well.
And on shoots, that goes off a skate. Time, all collided there with Cooley at the point, held by Seidler. Seidler Swings that back across the mile. Shoots. Bouncing puck in front. Garand is down. Henri tried to bank it in. Here's Canuck back with it. Canuck. Mile. Back for Seidler. Good pressure now by Switzerland. Seidler shoots. Loved by Garand, and he'll hang on.
Another shift with McTavish's line hemmed in their own end. Just kind of making plays along the wall, getting pucks out. Cooley gets a puck here, mishandles it, tries to protect it, gets knocked over. And then Bedard's not coming from underneath. He's hanging up above it. McTavish doesn't want to engage with the point man. Now they're running around and forced to play on their own end. When those guys are at their very best and world-class players when they're going the other way, Switzerland's done a good job of limiting their offense by making them play defense.
Shots are 5-0 Switzerland here in the third period. Delamont goes back as Wah moves in on him, and Delamont takes that away. Stolen back down by Wah. Joshua Wah spins it back in front, just missed Denoye with that pass. Denoye has taken the place of Greg as the center on this line for Canada. Zellweger spins it back in the corner for Dufour. Back to Zellweger. Zellweger shoots. The bouncing puck was blocked by Bachler. And it's loose at center ice. Sabrango up for Dufour. Chip set back down to the Swiss zone. And Cash rattles it right back around the boards. Seeley up ahead for Dufour. There's Piasco with it. He's got two so far today. And picked up by Seeley. Still to come tonight. The United States and Czechia in the fourth quarter final match tonight. Seeley plays that back. Jack Thompson back for Seeley. Austin tries to dig that free and does. A stop check got knocked off the puck. A stop check back for Cormier. And now Cormier works in, crisscrossing with Del Mastro. Cormier shoots, he fired that wide. Back at the point is Del Mastro to hold it. Hoffman's got a stick up in front with DePone. And that long shot now, they're going back at it. As Pash makes the save, both are going to go here. Logan Stankov has been noticeable on the score sheet. And physically, a spark plug for Canada with a 5-3 lead. Well, the NFL 2022 season kickoff comes your way September 8th with a Thursday night football showdown, the Bills and the Rams. Catch at 7 Eastern, 4 Pacific on TSN and CTV, Canada's home for the NFL. A little bit of... They're still going. DePone plays for St. John in the Quebec League. Hoffman plays for Flint in the OHL.
I'm trying to read lips here. It's either, they're back and forth. They're still going.
That's where the penalties were called.
Trying to draw one. It's unsuccessful.
So 4-on-4. Generally, if you have the lead, you want to play 5-on-5. But in this case, Canada might be better off at 4-on-4.
McTavish to Cormier, swings it back at Grant to Zellweger. Owen Zellweger to Lucas Cormier. Forrester swings it back across McTavish. Mason McTavish drops it back to Zellweger. Being shut out there by Canuck, plays it back in the corner. Forrester on it, knocked it down behind the goal, loose for McTavish. Now Forrester drops it back. Zellweger shoots, rifle that high. McTavish back with it, holds at the line, feeds across for Cormier. Back to McTavish. Between the legs he goes, walks in and shoots. Between the legs again?
No, second one was a regular shot, but worth noting, it was not Bedard out there with McTavish to start the 4-on-4. It's Forster.
Meantime, Hoffman and DePauw are still going out in the penalty box. Piasco, so much for cooling him off. Here's Johnson with it. Ken Johnson winds his way out. A minute to go in this 4-on-4. Johnson slithers in and slides it back to Stankovic. At the point is Thompson. Shoots! And that just missed. Stroyla Plays that back around. This 4-4 has been almost entirely in the Swiss zone. And Strohla back court, being flushed there by Johnson.
Good decision, pull your stick out of the body by Kent Johnson. Don't risk taking a penalty.
Strohla plays for Winnipeg in the Western League. That goes off the stick of Thompson over the glass and out of play. And yes, the conversation in the penalty box is pretty spicy between Vincent Dépoe and Brendan Hoffman.
I quite enjoy it. I like being down with the guys, get going back and forth. And a lot, most of the time, it stops, but I kind of like one that carries over. Polkovitz, Hoffman hasn't stopped yet. Well, same thing.
Meet you by the flagpole at recess. Seidler plays that back.
Well, the thing is, in a tournament like this, you can't afford to do anything silly. You can't lash out, you can't fight, you can't do any of those things. It's just, it's too risky.
Zellweger, game center ice. Bouncing puck, Hoffman and Dépoe step back on, go right to their respective benches. It's back down to the Canadian zone as Zellweger picks it up. Drops it back for Sabrango. And Donovan Sabrango to Will Cooley. Rink wide to Bedard. In comes Connor Bedard, shoots, it's off the stick of Chanton. And off the grass, and Bedard goes, Bedard goes right back to him.
I think he got Chanton with a high stick though as they hit each other.
No penalty coming. They're still jousting behind the net. Bedard's lost his stick. Cormier's got the puck back. For McTavish shoots. Fired that wide. Cooley back on it. Will Cooley feeds that back to Cormier. Works it in, shoots, trying to find the stick of McTavish there. That just missed. And O'Rourke plays it back around to McTavish. Mason McTavish. Slides that back to O'Rourke. Back to McTavish. A hard shot. Pad save by Pash. Rebound Cormier. And Pash has it. He's able to hang on. Canada keeps up the pressure of 5-3 here on Switzerland on the Wednesday quarterfinals here at the 2022 World Junior Hockey Championship.
Yeah, it's good to see your top players get involved physically. If it's not going for you, and we're well into the game, but it's a good way to kind of switch it up. Kind of Bedard trying to get involved offensively here, but gets a stick swung up on Chanton. He's holding his face as though he got hit. I'm not sure who did what, but it spurred on an offensive zone shift for that line. And ended up with a couple good chances for McTavish and for Cormier. And you know, we're hyper-analyzing every little thing that Connor Bedard does because he's such an important player on this team.
He's getting the same treatment that Sidney Crosby got in the 04 World Junior as a 16-year-old when everyone tried him. Everyone tried to, you know.
Right. Test him, push him.
You come in as the wonder kid, right? You're the hot new thing. Let's see how hot you are. And as we learned, very hard to knock Crosby off his game.
And Bedard, the same thing. The physical play hasn't bothered him at all.
No.
He certainly occasionally expresses frustration, which is not unique to him or really any player.
Forrester picks up that loose puck, throws it back, but it missed everyone. Goes back down the ice. Garand's got it back. This is going to be a long year for Connor Bedard, not in a bad way, but just all the talk leading up to the draft next summer. He's been the presumptive number one for so long for the 2023 draft. We will not see Matvei Michkov internationally.
Right.
As Russia is barred from international competition. And the Matvei Michkov situation is going to be really interesting for the draft for a couple of reasons. In a normal situation, he'd be second overall, but he's Russian.
Mm-hmm.
So if you want to take your chances on that, he's under contract for 3 more years after this, the SK St. Petersburg. So Connor Bedard will be the presumptive number one. There's Tom and Melanie Bedard from North Vancouver, Connor Bedard's parents.
And it's amazing and almost sad. Like, Connor, the family, they're probably kind of used to that scrutiny at this point because he's been around hockey's consciousness for 2-3 years now. It would be strange for him not to be in the spotlight.
Well, centering pass knocked away. Picked back up by Tybalt. When I say Michkov, you know, you might question, you know, taking him second overall because he's Russian. It's just the fact is the political atmosphere right now in the world. Do you make a Russian the second overall pick? That's a real question mark. And then the contract complicates.
It tells you how good he is that he warrants that conversation.
100%, he was dynamite at the 2021 under-18s. Dominant there. Now, wow, with a quick shot. That deflects wide.
This is better, though, for Canada. Chew up clock, territorial advantage.
Sabrango throws it back in front. That's kicked away from DeFore. This is the tough day, the quarterfinal day. Chance for Benoit, turned away. If you lose today, you're done. If you win, you know you're playing Saturday for a medal, no matter what. Wow, with a chance, that's turned away. And over the years, there have been so many upsets in the corners in these tournaments. At the Olympics, the World Championship, this tournament.
Different level of upset if one of the big four lost today.
Backhand shot by Wah.
But they almost did, yeah.
Would Czechia against the U.S. be a massive upset?
Yes. Given what we've seen at this point in the tournament, I think so. But so would this, and Switzerland's hanging within two. So would Latvia versus...
Latvia's tied with Sweden in the third period. So, and even Germany was within a goal of Finland in the third period of that first game today. It started at 10 o'clock local time. Ostapchuk tries to sweep that back across, tripling the blue line.
Tough toe pick. He was almost in on the two-on-one.
Hoffman back across for Ostapchuk. Held by Gaucher, feeds it back down inside. Seven to go here in the third period. Semifinals are here on Friday. The bronze and gold medal games come your way Saturday. And then it's off to Halifax and Moncton, where if you missed it earlier, the groups were announced. Cormier plays it ahead. The medal round games in the 2023 tournament, which was to be held in Russia, will be in Halifax. Russia was stripped of the hosting duties for the 2023 World Junior and the Men's Worlds in 23, which is to be in a brand new building in St. Petersburg.
Oh, well, East Coast flavor will be nice.
McTavish centers. Oh, what a chance for Mark. Turned away, tight rebound.
Oh, skates out. He saved it.
Vincent Depot got his stick on, or skate on that. A kick save to rob Bedard of a goal.
How good was that footwork in behind Pash? Broken coverage, not the guy you want to leave standing all alone. He's trying to open up and then go five-fall. Oh, this ball gets the skate sideways, kicks it out. Make sure not to get your glove on it. Let the goaltender cover it up. That would have gone in over the line for a goal. DePaul takes it right off the goal line. As I tell you what, Wendy Johnson was watching the game. She would not be that calm if I was trying to score a goal.
No,
my mom would be.
Your dad is cool as a cucumber.
My dad, more so.
Yeah.
Mom, not as much.
Well,
she'd be rooting on her honey. Everybody who played for Team Canada that day would be honey.
What?
Oh, honey, go. Come on, honey.
Really?
Yeah.
Bedard works it and shoots top escape. Did she call me that during broadcast?
She might now.
Oh, yeah?
I'll check in with her after the game.
Good to know. Cooley puts it wide. And Seeley ranges back. And watched there by Tybalt. Comes in the corner now. That centering pass missed the stick of Canuck, who had the first Swiss goal in the game on a deflection. Now Canuck shoots, and was blocked by Cooley. Tries again, it's off a skate high. Bachler back with it. Back at the point, Seidler. Works it and shoots, that's blocked by Cooley. Seidler gets it back, shoots again, bouncing puck in front, skipped away from Alge. Cooley steps into him, Alge trying to dig it free.
Yourself.
There's five guys over that puck. And Seeley picks it up.
Got to skate. No, Bedard, no stick. Got to skate it out.
Brought in by Dionisio. Shoots. Grand pen save. The rebound skipped away from
Ritzler. Too many Canadians out there right now. Way too many Canadians.
There are six Canadian skaters on the ice. There were. And I'll drop back. Johnson with a chance. Turn away by Pash. Rebound. Loose in front. Pash down again. Johnson trying to dig it free. Canada had six skaters on the ice for a good 10 seconds. Johnson drops it back for Zellweger. Zellweger feeds it across. Johnson, a sharp angle shot. That deflects away. Sabrango. That could have been costly there in a 5-3 game.
There was all mayhem at the bench, and yeah, there was a clear six. Stankoven was all the way almost on the far blue line.
Late pass to Forster, walking in. Feeds across to Johnson. Bouncing putt pass. Got a piece of that.
Shoot the puck. Somebody shoot the puck.
Stankoven turns that over. And it's bumped back out by Biasca. Now Cormier throws that in, but it goes over the glass and out. 3:46 to go here in the third period. Connor Bedard's come close. Turned away by Pash. And then DePaul with a skate save. As a defenseman for Switzerland, Canada leads by two.
Dave Cameron trying to coach his team to a strong finish. They've been better than this third period, but they almost got caught in a big mistake. Too many men. So we'll watch it coming back in their zone. There's one, two, three, four, five guys. Look at Stankoven. He's at the far blue line with five guys fully involved on the back check in the defensive zone. It wasn't on a change. It wasn't stretch it out. It was way too many men. Now, a lot's going on at the bench. But I'm surprised that Switzerland wasn't erupting more, because right. The benches are usually right on it. It's just too many guys. It feels funny.
Right.
And no one picked up on it. Big time break for Canada.
3:45 to go here in the third period. Canada, 13-3 all time in quarterfinal meetings. Canada has been to the gold medal game for the last 5 years of the World Junior Championship.
Good news, the last 7 minutes of this period, Canada's been really strong. Been in the offensive zone, had control, haven't asked Dylan Garand to do much, haven't forced themselves to play in their own end where they're not as good as playing in the offensive end.
It was 4-1 when Switzerland made the goaltending change, taking Patenaude out and put Pash in. He stopped 30 of 31 shots to keep this a game. Knocked out by Canuck. Going to be blown dead in the offensive zone, and the faceoff will come outside.
And here we go. McTavish is doing the faceoff get-off. He was in on the ice for the defensive zone faceoff. Now the high stick brings the faceoff to the neutral zone, and Denoyer can go out there and take the neutral zone faceoff with his usual line. Without Ridley Gregg now.
Yes.
Although Stankoven has the best faceoff percentage in the tournament, it's the post-faceoff play that they want McTavish there for as well. So you wonder if it's on the right side of it, Stankoven, and left side, McTavish, the rest of the way.
Seeley turns that over to Allensbach.
Pass is creeping.
And here he comes. Seedler lays that back to Delmont. Extra skater comes out as Canuck. Rink wide, Allensbach. Six skaters on five now. For Switzerland, Seedler back across to Delmont. Back in the corner for Farney. All the big guns out there for Switzerland. Delamont works it and shoots. It was off the leg of Seeley. And now through line with an empty net. Denoyer works it on Seedler. In comes Denoyer. Drops it back.
No.
Delamont 3-on-2 now for Switzerland the other way.
Oh.
Sabrango up for Wild. Flips it ahead. Rolling puck goes to Seedler with Denoyer closing on him.
The empty net drop pass.
Now Dufour fans on it. Seedler. Up ahead for Biasca, who's been terrific here tonight. 2.5 to go in the third period. Picked out by Tybalt. Loose puck in front. Garand is down. Still loose. And Tybalt couldn't reach it. Banked up by Dufour. In comes Tybalt. Straightened up by Cooley. That shoot hit a discarded stick there. And now Del Mastro sends it down. Icing call against Canada. The faceoff back down to their zone.
And Biasca again. Very dangerous. There's a chance. It's a 3-on-2, so you know he kind of overskates the puck here. But if you have this, you got to keep moving forward. You try to chip that back. You just don't. Not in that situation. You put yourself in a position for something bad to happen. And scramble time in and around the net. Desperation defense for Canada trying to finish this game off. No timeout yet. They need two, so you got to save the timeout in case you get one.
So McTavish for the faceoff. against Farney. Logan Stankoven came into this game as the number one faceoff man of the tournament. That faceoff won by Farney. Back to side. Seidler. Delamont took it off. Now picked up by Forrester. And Forrester lifts it back to center ice. McTavish going on Seidler. Knocks it by him, but it's left down by Cooley. Plays it back down to the Swiss zone. Allenspach blocked by Forrester. Has to swing back. Rink wide is Seidler. Chipped in by Canuck, but back goes Thompson.
Good play, good chop by Thompson.
These top guys have been out for over a minute and a half for Switzerland. They'll stay out. Seidler off ahead for Biasca. Canuck plays it back around. Loose puck for Stankoven. At the line, knocked down by Kent Johnson. Feeds ahead for Stankoven. Logan Stankoven's got a break score! And Logan Stankoven puts the exclamation point on what's been a great game for him.
What a game for Stankoven. You wonder why you put offensive players out with the empty net sometimes to kill it, to make, because you have to make plays with the puck. And this is what Kent Johnson does. So he gets his puck on the boards here and chips it out safely, makes a nice play. And yes, it's the middle of the ice, but he has support underneath. There's clearly a pass he could make, and it ends the game. That's why sometimes, you know, as long as they're defensively aware, put guys on the ice who can make passes, which is really what you have to do to end the game, is a good idea. Kent Johnson was once again brilliant with the puck in this one. Stankoven and his and that line were the difference makers.
So it appears as though the Swiss tournament will end here in the quarterfinals, but they acquitted themselves pretty well in this tournament. Gave some teams some scares, including Canada in this quarterfinal matchup. A pass picked up at center ice by Tybell. Back at Bronze, Henri shoots. That's gloved by Graham, and he'll hang on. So now we'll wait to see the result of the USA-Czechia game tonight. Logan Stankoven, a Kamloops native, plays for the Kamloops Blazers. Second-round pick of Dallas in 2021.
And first star of the night in this one is he was dancing right from the get-go and finishes off his great night with an easy empty netter. You know why? Nice pass. Nice pass, Johnny.
45 goals in 59 games in the regular season for him. 17-17 in the playoffs.
He made a good point about Switzerland. They have their offensive guys on the ice for so long, Gord. At some point, it's hard to keep playing as hard as you need to to get to the loose pucks when you've been out there for 90 seconds against defensive players who have changed over two or three times.
Right. So Canada's going to run its record against Switzerland to 25-0 all time in this tournament.
Wasn't easy.
And O'Rourke picks it out. And Canada is off to the semis against an opponent yet to be determined based on the result of the United States-Czechia quarterfinal game tonight, the last of four quarterfinals on this day in this building. The Swiss will finish eighth.
Offense, even not their best game, still plenty of firepower for Canada. Their ability to finish on the chances they create separates them from just about everybody in this tournament. And now they've gotten to the spot where they were expected to get to. And they'll play more difficult opponent in the semifinals. But you got, did you hear that? What a struggle. That was Dylan Grant. So, sums it up. Wasn't easy, but they got the job done.
And time now for the player of the game presentations and then the Canadian anthem. And we'll also have the top three players of the tournament for Switzerland.
Well, the players of the game seem to be Stankoven's
the best player
be.
Of each team is awarded a one-of-a-kind hockey stick, hand-painted by one of Canada's most prolific contemporary Indigenous visual artists, Jason Carter. The prizes will be presented by Bruce Simpson, owner of William Hoff Advertising. The best player of Team Switzerland est le numéro 17, number 17, Attilio Biasca.
He was terrific with a couple of goals here today. Had a great tournament for them. Plays for Halifax and the Quebec Major Junior.
The best player of Team Canada est le numéro 10, number 10, Logan Stankoven.
He was great from the start, wasn't he?
CHL Player of the Year. Incredible playoff. Obviously a clutch player. Get to the elimination games, and he has his very best one.
Ferenc Tiana on the left and Wes on the right.
And now, for the three best players of the 2022 IIHF World Junior Championship for Team Switzerland. The three best players are selected by their team and will each receive a Tissot watch. The three best players of Team Switzerland are number 8, le numéro 8, Simon Knoch.
He was good.
Yeah. National 6th
number 12,
pick.
Le numéro 12, Dario Allenspach.
Involved a lot of offense as well for Switzerland.
And number 17, et le numéro 17, Attilio Biasca.
Winds up with 4 goals in 5 games in the tournament. Next year, Switzerland will play in Group B in Moncton with the United States, Finland, Slovakia, and Latvia.
Now, please rise for the national anthem of Canada. Maintenant, merci de vous lever afin d'écouter l'hymne national du Canada.
To no one's surprise, Canada advances. Switzerland battled valiantly. It's time for NHL Tonight.